फर्जी कंपनियां पकड़ी गई और उसी कारण आपको जमानत पे निकलना पड़ा।
Good evening, Namaskar, Adab. Today was the day when Supreme Court was to tell us whether the Centre's Act of sending the Central Bureau of Investigation Director Alok Verma on forced leave, was that act based on fact? Were there merit in the allegations which were being levelled against Alok Verma? CBC was told very, very clearly by the Supreme Court to wrap up his probe into these allegations being made against Verma within 2 weeks under the guidance of a retired Supreme Court judge. But take a look at what happens. The CBC ends up missing the deadline to submit his probe report exactly by 12 hours. The Chief Justice of India tells the CBC and his legal counsel that, listen, we kept the court registrar open till 11:30 last night. Why didn't you do that? To which the government's legals responded, we're sorry, my lord, we couldn't do it. We've done it now. All that's happened is that case, which was to have been decided upon today, has now been shifted till next Friday. So the fate of Alok Verma hangs by a thread till next Friday. And the government, as well as the CBI, gets a lifeline till next Friday. And what exactly was the Central Bureau of Investigation busy with today? This is what the Central Bureau of Investigation was doing. Attending a meeting to calm one's mind, to avoid cynicism, to focus on optimism, to look at the Central Bureau of Investigation as a center of great virtue, as a hallmark of morality. Over 200 CBI sleuths were busy attending an Art of Living Foundation program in Bangalore. There in Supreme Court, all hell was breaking loose. There in Supreme Court, the CBC was supposed to be giving a probe report. And this is what was being done by the Central Bureau of Investigation. Pretty obviously, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, the Art of Living Foundation boss, was happy with the optimism, with the synergy which he was generating. So on Viewpoint tonight, folks, there are two big stories that are playing out. On a day when the government gets a lifeline till next Friday, on CBI's war within, the center does not miss the opportunity to tell the court that it has nothing to hide on Rafale deal. In a 16-page report, the government has now told the petitioners seeking a court-monitored SIT probe that they have absolutely nothing to hide. That's our big story number one. Has Modi Sarkar really managed to douse the fire of Rafale? And big story number two is coming from Chhattisgarh, the state which has kicked off the polling process, first phase of poll taking place, 18 seats. But what has actually generated a lot of interest and hype is not just the fact that polling percentage was 70%. The name-calling business, the Prime Minister referring to Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi as a Ma Beta company which were out to cheat the country and now being called out because of demonetization. And the Delhi BJP chief Manoj Tiwari also using words to describe Sonia Gandhi as a bad mother. This entire business of name calling, is it really going to be the road ahead? Is this what is going to set the template ahead of 2019? That's going to be our big story number two. So it's a packed show ahead on the program tonight. Let's straight away begin first with our big story number one and take you straight to the heart of what actually happened in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court was of great interest today because, as I said, we were supposed to be told about the fate of the CBI director. That story being pushed till Friday. But the government not missing an opportunity to tell the country that they have nothing to hide. So this is what the government has done today. They have submitted a 16-page probe report meant for the petitioners who were arguing that there is dal mein kuch ghotala somewhere. So therefore, there must be a court-monitored SIT probe. The centre is now contending that this deal for purchase of Rafale aircraft was finalised as per the UPA's own 2013 procurement procedure. What was the allegation being made by the Congress party led by Kapil Sibal and Rahul Gandhi? It had violated the entire deal for purchase of these 36 aircrafts, had violated procedures. The Ministry for External Affairs was not kept in the loop. Response number two. Nirmala Sitharaman led Defence Ministry saying no private business house named in India-France agreement. For the better part of the last 3 months, what have we been told? Rahul Gandhi has held multiple press conferences where he has said unfair gains were to be accrued to a private business house via offset contracts And the only reason why Modi Sarkar went in for this Rafale deal is because this private group, this private company was supposed to have been the beneficiary of offsets worth 30,000 crore rupees. Allegation number three also being rebutted today through that report. The Cabinet Committee on Security cleared the Rafale deal is the straightforward assertion being made by the government. The argument being made by the opposition was that all laws were bypassed. There was only one person who knew about this decision of purchasing these aircrafts, and that was the Prime Minister. The government has also said that 74 meetings held with the French. These were the number of meetings which were held with the French. Talks had gone on for over a year. The opposition has obviously maintained the defense establishment was kept in complete dark. There was no one, whether in the army or the air force or anywhere else in the defense establishment, who was aware of this. The NDA's deal is at far better terms and prices versus the UPA deal. Now, the truth is that the UPA actually did not lead to completion of the deal. So how do you compare these two? If a deal doesn't get fructified and a deal gets fructified, do you make a comparison between a deal which never got materialized versus a deal which ends up being materialized? The opposition has said the NDA deal is cheaper than why just 36 aircrafts, because the original RFP which was floated by the opposition was meant for 126 aircrafts. On the basis of clear-cut assertions now being made by the government, in none less than the Supreme Court, I believe the government has done what we have been asking for. Here on Viewpoint, I have held this position for a very long time that the best way to solve this entire crisis, to douse the fire around Rafale, is to put out a white paper. The government has done exactly that. All facts now on the Rafale deal in one consolidated report. Should have been done earlier, but I'm happy that it's been done now. Now that the matter is with the Supreme Court, and if there are no other facts which are relevant to this case, opposition may well be forced to admit that they are perhaps guilty of simply creating a political balloon. Either there are more facts which come out, either there are facts which challenge the version which is being put out by the government, either the Supreme Court disagrees with what we believe are facts which are being put out by the government, maybe these are just claims, or the opposition admits that this is nothing else but plain political speak that we're talking about. Let's raise a big blunt question on the program, Rafale politics. Has Modi government effectively doused Rafale fire with this all facts out report which is there before the Supreme Court? Full political panel joining us to answer that question, Narendra Taneja of the BJP, taking him on, Mohammad Khan, spokesperson of the Congress Party, legal Vikas Singh, one of the country's most eminent lawyers, is there with us, and so is Shantanu Sen, former joint director of the Central Bureau of Investigation. Warm welcome to all of you. Let me kick off first with the CBI man. Since the day was to be dedicated to the CBI, and since there was this allegation which was being made, Shantanu Sen, that one of the reasons why Alok Verma was sent on forced leave is because he was about to order some kind of a probe in this Rafale deal, which Alok Verma subsequently himself has outrightly denied. But let me put it this way, sir. Now that the government has put out all facts straight before the Supreme Court, do you believe this is where the story ends? Are you satisfied with the version being put out by the NDA that all we have done is simply followed the guideline, the rule book, which was put in place by the UPA itself?
It's not a question of our satisfaction, it is a question of the Supreme Court's satisfaction. If the Supreme Court is satisfied, I am satisfied.
But are you just on the basis, I can take you through the points, sir. It's a 16-page probe report. In that 16-page probe report, the government makes it clear that the government had formed a team of negotiators led by Deputy Chief of Air Staff Rank Officer. The team submits its report in July 2016. A total of 74 meetings have been held. The CCS was in the loop. All allegations being made by the Congress Party are all false. Now that these claims are being made before the Supreme Court, do we take these claims as facts, or do we just say that these are mere claims and therefore, well, let's wait for a while?
No, there is a nigger in the woodpile. It's regarding the Anil Ambani connection. I think the outrage is there. The HAL is a public sector company, and 22,000 or more employees would have been probably inducted if the HAL was responsible for the manufacture and putting out on work the Rafale planes. Mm. That is the question which affects the public.
Mm.
A public sector, why was it simply ousted?
Mm.
That satisfaction must come.
Okay. So,
after all, we are still a developing country and we believe that our public sectors must be given full support.
Okay.
And Anil Ambani, yes, he's a businessman and he has a right to business, but he must earn it through his own merit and not ride piggyback on the government.
Mohammad Khan,
government,
the question of
must
Anil Ambani.
Always go out for public sectors.
Yes, sir. But you know, but the truth,
that is our feeling.
Yeah, but the truth, Shantanu Sen, is also this, that there are many experts who believe that maybe the financials or the costing arrangement which was being worked out by HAL was simply unsustainable. And therefore, even though the French, the Dassault CEO Eric Trappier did say this at some stage, that they were about to close a deal with HAL, but he ended up going with Anil Ambani-led group, maybe because he felt that Dassault's interests were being served better there. But Mohammad Khan, the 16-page report which has now been shared by the government, Mohammad Khan,
The money doesn't matter. The money doesn't matter.
One moment, sir. Now Mohammad Khan, the government says that contrary to what Rahul Gandhi has been saying, that 30,000 crore rupees has been given to one private group. The government says no money has been given to any private group. Now, that's a viewpoint which has been expressed earlier by Anil Ambani Group as well. Are we in any position to dispute this statement which is being made by the government?
Yes, we are.
How?
I'll tell you why we are. Because, and here Mr. Prashant Bhushan is to be thanked, he actually tweeted the annual report of the Reliance Group. Now, he said, the Reliance annual statement, which clearly stated that the JV will discharge offset obligations worth 30,000 crores. He's put up a screenshot of it on 12th October 2018. Anyone can go and see it. Reliance Infrastructure Limited. In fact, it says, and I quote, to kick off this project, our subsidiary, Reliance Aerostructures, has formed a joint venture company with Dassault Aviation. The joint venture shall facilitate the transfer of high-end technology while discharging offset obligations of INR 30,000 crores. So when RIL itself is putting this up, and I gave you the date of the tweet so you yourself can go and verify, why are they now trying to turn around and rewrite this narrative?
Okay.
Two other points, Bhupenji, which you raised at the start of the debate. Let me address those. The government is claiming that the Cabinet Committee on Security cleared the project. I say they didn't, and they are lying in court. I'll tell you why.
That's because a serious allegation.
Modi wasn't,
you are saying the government is lying in the Supreme Court of the country.
That's a very serious allegation.
That's a very serious allegation that you're making, and I hope you're making those allegations on the basis of fact.
I'll tell you why.
How?
Absolutely, Bhupenji, I respect you and your viewers far too much to make empty statements here. I say this because the day Mr. Modi made this announcement in France is the same day that Mr. Manohar Parikar, the defense minister of the country, was unwittingly carrying out inaugurations of some fisheries project. When he was asked about this, he did not know. This is a matter on record. The Cabinet Committee on Security gave retrospective clearance to the project. That is our first allegation. Secondly, they keep talking about the fact that the aircraft that they are purchasing are magnificently endowed with some advanced features which the UPA deal did not have. Let me read out to you, and here again, Mr. Arun Jaitley has unwittingly tweeted the joint statement between Mr. Modi and the French president. On 10th April 2015, the statement was made, in which, in paragraph 14 of which, they said that the aircraft, the associated systems and weapons are all being issued on the same specifications as were tested by the Air Force. This is available to anyone. Paragraph 14, 10th April 2015, joint statement between Prime Minister Modi
and let's take it one by one.
Let's take it one by one.
Narendra Taneja joining in as well.
Yeah.
Taneja ji, look at what Mohammad Khan is saying.
Yeah.
He's openly leveling this allegation that the government is lying. The NDA government is lying in the Supreme Court.
Perjury.
Now, I would say, it's a case of perjury. If the NDA government is lying in the Supreme Court, Taneja ji, either you prove to Mohammad Khan today that Mohammad Khan is lying, and therefore let's call out his bluff. Did the government really keep the CCS in the loop? Mohammad Khan says the government did not keep the CCS in the loop. What's the reality, sir? Let's take it point by point.
No. Bhupen, listen. The point here is very clear. If Mohammad Khan or Rahul Gandhi ji or any other leader or the party as a whole, If that is their view, why don't they put down their views in writing with some evidence? I'm sure they must be having some evidence, and go to the Supreme Court tomorrow, give it to the Supreme Court under a sealed envelope. They don't want to share with you or with me or with the people of this country. They should just go and give it to the Supreme Court since they have the evidence. You know, it's very simple. It's very easy to come on television channel and question everyone because you know their names. You have read their names in media, defense minister, prime minister and all that. And question anybody. You see, Rahul Gandhi is the new Kejriwal. You know, you go for all kind of false allegations. Then you go to court, say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, main maafi mangta hun. This is what Rahul Gandhi is going to say. Just wait for some time.
So you are
he
saying
is the new Kejriwal.
So Tanejaji, you are saying clearly. So Tanejaji, you are saying clearly the CCS was kept in the loop.
Just a second. Last
the CCS was kept
last
in the loop, Tanejaji.
No, no. Look. Listen. The point is the in this court, the government has made it very clear that all the procedures, every single procedure. In accordance with the law, in accordance with the established practice, you know, and you know all these things, the cabinet secretary is involved. And cabinet secretary knows all these things better than Mohammed Khan or any other person. So that is done. The second point, I think the confusion probably where this is coming from, they think that making an announcement of a deal or an agreement and concluding the deal are the same thing. We, India announced 1 year ago that we will buy S-400 shield missiles from Russia. But we signed the deal 1 year after that. You know, you announce it. Announcing does not necessarily mean that you have to immediately formalize or legalize it. You know, when because you think there will not be an opportunity again for two head of states to meet. So let's make this announcement. And then, so that's where they might be. I suspecting that.
Mohammed Khan, are you willing to accept your confusion?
Making an announcement is basically legalizing and formalizing.
Before I go to
S-400, I'm giving you an example.
Are you willing to accept?
S-400
was giving a very clear cut
1 year ago.
Tanejaji is giving a very clear cut example.
Yes, please,
Mohammed Khan.
Yes, Taneja sahab, my attack is not against you as a person. My attack is simply that you are lying to the nation. And I say that with great responsibility because the evidence available before us points otherwise. Taneja sahab, you're right. We have taken 30 pieces of evidence taken from the public domain, from your websites, and put it before the Comptroller and Auditor General. We've put it before you. And we've said, please have the courage of your convictions and call for a joint parliamentary sitting so this can be investigated.
No, Mr. Khan. Mr. Khan, one moment.
But one moment.
Vendor, sir. No, hear me out.
I just have one rebuttal.
Yeah, Tanejaji, one moment. Now, the fact is this, Mohammed Khan, that when the UPA was in power and when the BJP was in opposition, Subramaniam Swamy and a whole host of other BJP leaders did go to the Supreme Court. The 2G episode became a scam because people went to the Supreme Court. Now here you have Prashant Bhushan led Common Cause and you have a couple of other activists who are going to the Supreme Court. I want to know if Mohammed Khan and Rahul Gandhi are so very clear that dal mein kuch hai kala, toh phir aap kyun nahi jaate Supreme Court? Why does the Congress party shy away from directly approaching the
absolutely.
Supreme Court?
मैं जवाब देता हूँ आपका जायज सवाल है और आपका जवाब ये है nobody especially Mr. Taneja and his party colleagues have the right to dictate to us which forum we go to. We
that's not no but that's not the answer. That's not the answer.
No, Bhupenji.
You said what did the court directed that the CAG should investigate?
Who investigated 2G? Was it not the CAG?
Yes. So I'm saying.
You're making me laugh, Mohammed Khan.
Taneja sahab, I'm glad you're laughing. on your way out of power.
If you say, Mohammed Khan, hear me out.
Why can't you?
If you are clear that Taneja ji's party is lying, Mohammed Khan, you have gone to the extent of saying that the government is lying in the Supreme Court. And therefore, I'm only going by what you say.
Absolutely.
If you are so clear that the government is lying in the Supreme Court, why is the opposition, why is the Congress party not going to the Supreme Court? Is Prashant Bhushan the crutches on which the Congress must walk? Is that the reality? Then you tell me. I'll take it.
No, Bhupendra.
If that's the reality.
That is a very... Okay, now you give me 30 seconds to respond.
Please.
I've heard you patiently. Now give me 30 seconds to respond.
Sure.
First of all, let me answer this in the following fashion. Look, the CAG is a constitutional authority. in the 2G case as well, and whether you agree with me or disagree with me, this is a fact. Even in the 2G cases, when they went to the Supreme Court, the court directed the CAG to carry out an investigation. That is a fact, because they are the body empowered to carry out these investigations. In fact, we have been credited by a number of independent people for going to the CAG, and the CAG has not refused to exercise jurisdiction. That alone points to the fact that it is the appropriate forum. Okay. Number two, Mr. Taneja, with due respect, you are nobody to tell us to go to the Supreme Court or otherwise. And finally, this, Taneja Saab says that, look, you can make an announcement and follow up a deal later with the processes. Taneja Saab, it wasn't that simple. Our Prime Minister went there. He made a statement that we are buying X number of aircraft. He made it a decision and he said that this is what is happening. And
let me bring in Vikas. Let me bring in Vikas.
That's why it's violative of the procedure.
Vikas ji, the Congress and the BJP will of course go at each other.
Give
hard.
Me 10 seconds.
Yeah. Taneja ji, one more. I just want to bring in Vikas Singh to settle the legal part. Taneja ji's argument that if the Congress is so clear, must go to the Supreme Court. Mohammad Khan saying the government is lying, but the government going on record, Vikas Singh, to say that there is no money which has been paid to Anil Ambani Group in this entire deal. Where do you stand? Is the government on a weak wicket here? Is the government just making empty claims before the Supreme Court, Vikas ji?
Well, I'll tell you, firstly, if the government has filed an affidavit, I mean, there is no government of the day who can risk filing a false affidavit. So if they've said something on affidavit, I'm sure they will be sufficient material to back whatever they
on a scale
said.
Of 100. Vikas ji, one moment. On a scale of 100, would you say, Vikas ji, on a scale of 100, the possibility of the government lying would be at 99 or would that be 1? Because I'm only trying to settle the argument which has been made by the Congress party that the government is lying in the Supreme Court.
Lying would be below 10, definitely below 10.
Below 10.
But I have, Bhupen, a more basic issue in this matter.
Sure,
when I say that the government has no right to bring in a law as far as the mandir is concerned, because I feel that there is separation of powers. According to me, this is also not a matter where Supreme Court should examine at all. Because if the Supreme Court starts examining, then people like Prashant Bhushan and M.L. Sharma will say, No, Rafale is not a good jet. You should go into another jet. And tomorrow they'll start looking at the specification of the jets also and say, no, but why did you buy this jet? That jet had a higher speed and that jet had a higher projection, etc. So this is completely out of bound of the Supreme Court. According to me, Supreme Court should not get into this at all. This is where I have a very serious objection into the encroachment of the powers of the Supreme Court into the executive functioning.
But the matter is there before the
court. This is a line which is clearly demarcated by the Supreme Court itself.
Fair enough, Vikas ji.
They have entertained the matter.
Yes.
And they will have to go by the affidavits and they will have to leave it at that. It is not as if, they have to do a roving inquiry into the entire deal. And if the affidavit had said something, there are enough laws of the land today in this country to prove that an affidavit is wrong. And I'm sure people can use the RTI and so many other means to say that that affidavit is wrong.
No, let
and
me hear
this
clearly.
This matter is closed today on the basis of this affidavit.
That's
tomorrow,
a question.
Tomorrow a perjury can be filed.
So one moment, sir.
Somebody filing Vikas
ji, Vikas ji, does this Rafale matter rest here now that the government has put this on a sworn affidavit? Now that those details have been shared with those who are asking for a court-monitored SIT probe, does this matter rest here, Vikas ji? Is my straight question to you.
I according to me, it should definitely rest here. The court has to only look into the decision-making process and not get into the actual decision. If the government of the day has put it on affidavit that the decision-making process was scrupulously followed, the matter should end there, because there is a certain presumption in law, even under the Evidence Act, for every governmental action to have been done in a regular fashion. And if the government has further, affirmed it by an affidavit, then that should really seal the matter and the matter should close. The court is not, a forum where you should start a roving inquiry or on the basis of conjectures and surmises and say a false affidavit has been filed, unless you have material to show. Even what the Congress representative is saying here is merely a projection of Reliance Ambani. Now, if Ambani has projected that it will give 30,000 crore in future, and if the government says it has not paid a single penny, I don't think there is any inconsistency between what the government is saying and what Ambani has said.
Shantanu
Ambani may project whatever, but if no payment has been made to him, it has not been made to him.
Then
and
that's
that is the end of the matter.
So, Shantanu
what they project that they will get in future is of no consequence.
Does the matter rest here then? Shantanu ji, does the matter rest here? Vikas Singh is very clear. that Supreme Court can now not get into investigation of whether an affidavit which has been submitted by a court, by a government, whether that affidavit is based on empty claims or is it based on fact. Where do you stand, sir? Does the matter rest here, Shantaruji?
The matter may rest in the Supreme Court, but politically it will be still battled out. Supreme Court will take a decision as per law, and Mr. Vikas Singh, being the senior advocate here, being the legal expert, I would tend to agree with him and go by his views.
Hmm.
But I don't think the matter will at all end.
No, politically, let's let the political spokesperson deal with that.
Battled out in the field of
politics.
Yeah,
sure, sir. Politics. I'm only trying to look at facts
and
here.
Then
so I want to be clear whether, legally speaking, whether this matter rests here, Shantaruji. On the basis of what Vikas Singh is saying, on the basis of the fact that the government is telling the Supreme Court that we have not paid any money, that Anil Ambani has not been paid money. If Anil Ambani has not been paid money, then Anil Ambani has not been paid money. Now, either there is proof that Anil Ambani has been paid money, either there is proof that there is some loss to the exchequer, you and I have lost some money. If there is no proof, is this just a convenient political smokescreen, sir? That's my question today.
No, you are right. The matter should rest here. The Supreme Court will accept the affidavit because Mr. Vikas Singh is absolutely right. The government acts as per law.
Hmm.
When you sit there, you look at the government acting according to law all the time.
Hmm.
And you have to prove that it did not act according to the law. If the other side cannot prove that, the matter will certainly rest where it is.
Hmm.
But the other fact about Ambani coming in, that matter will still not rest.
That matter
because the country certainly demands an answer.
Mohammad Khan,
why the public sector was ousted.
What will you do, Mohammad Khan? Look at the legal argument being made here, that the matter must rest here. The Supreme Court cannot get into investigation of what is the basis on which an affidavit has been submitted in a court.
Bhupenji, Vikas sir said something, and I respectfully, despite having the highest regard for him, disagree. Sir, Vikas sir, I agree with you that there is that presumption under the Evidence Act, but here there are compelling evidences that you need to consider. Number one, Vikas sir, if we were to distill this matter into its two simplest formulations, it would be this. The government bought fewer aircraft for a higher price. Number two, it removed an experienced company from the offset contract and gave it to a company whose only qualification was its proximity to the Prime Minister.
That's an argument. How's that a fact?
We need investigation.
That's an argument.
Now,
that's not a fact.
Now, wait. Now let me.
How do you
this.
Prove this?
I'll
I'm
come
saying,
to the
how
fact
do you prove
now.
This? That's where. That's where the argument
right.
is now. That Bhupenji, if you say
2016,
if you say that person X has been a beneficiary because of his proximity to person B, now either you prove that because of
let's
this proximity, this deal has happened.
Let's prove it.
Otherwise, we're talking politics here. Let's be clear.
I agree with you. Let's prove it. Now, first of all, let's remember the fact that a year before the Prime Minister goes and inks this deal, Subhash Bhamre, the sitting Minister of State for Defence, gives a statement on the floor of Parliament giving us the price per Rafale aircraft. And he doesn't invoke any secrecy clause at that time. He answers the question straightforward, and that price is the price that was negotiated by the UPA.
Okay.
Suddenly, after Mr. Modi renegotiates the deal, this becomes a secret. Mr. Macron comes to an Indian channel and he says that, boss, there's nothing preventing you from discussing this with the opposition. Number two, we get our hands on Rafale's, that is Dassault's, annual report, where they have no compunction or hesitation in revealing the price India has paid per aircraft. So clearly, it's not a secret. Now, let's come to the crony capitalism angle. Bhupenji, and this is a very serious accusation, a company that has been formed 15 days prior to the announcement made by the Prime Minister, a company that has never ventured into this space, a company that has
you blame
no
the French for that
whatsoever.
You blame the
suddenly
French for that.
Replacing an 80-year-old, replacing
you blame
an
the French for that.
Company is a big thing. Now you say blame the French for that.
Yeah.
You say blame you the French for
you,
that.
You
very
go
good.
You go sue
but
the French
then Hollande, but then Hollande comes out.
Yes.
Yes, fine. Hmm. But then Mr. Hollande, the former president, comes out or Prime Minister comes out, and he says that we were compelled to take these people. We were told you have no choice.
Now
in the
again,
matter.
I must say there have been multiple. There have been multiple viewpoints which have been expressed.
No, now
there have been multiple viewpoints which have been expressed from Hollande, from Hollande to Macron to Eric Trappier himself. Every person is speaking in multiple ways. Yeah, yeah, I know. That's what I'm saying. Eric Trappier's position.
No, Eric Trappier comes to your channel.
Yes, sir.
And
that's what I'm saying. I don't know who to believe. Every person is saying.
I'll tell you. Bhupenji, mujhe mera aakhri point sun lijiye, uske baad you draw your own conclusion.
Please tell me.
Now, Eric Trappier comes to your channel and he gives an interview and says that the reason we chose Reliance is because they had land. Now, the land in question is not allotted at the time when they inked the deal. It was allotted much after they inked
now,
the deal.
Now, Taneja ji.
Someone forgot to tell Mr. Taneja
Taneja ji, there is
this happened.
Macron.
This is a
there is President Hollande. And there is Eric Trappier. On one hand. Now, see, again, Mohammed Khan will say all this is jhoot pe jhoot. On one hand, there are contrarian multiple viewpoints being expressed by the French authorities themselves. On the other hand, now your government has gone and you have put this on affidavit in Supreme Court. Are you willing to say this with your hand on your heart, sir, that every word which has been put up in that affidavit is absolute fact? That there is not an iota of a lie there, as Mohammed Khan wants us to believe.
Bhupen, you have... Bhupen, you allowed Mohammed Khan 10 minutes. Allow me at least 3 minutes.
Now,
the point is, the Supreme Court gave a very clear option to the government. Supreme Court gave a very clear option to the government in terms of pricing. If the government didn't want to disclose the price, they said if the government thought it was exclusive, Supreme Court, you don't have to do it. You can just file an affidavit and saying you can't do it, and the court would accept it. But what the government did, we have shared the information with the Supreme Court. We have shared pricing information, every information, because it's the Supreme Court. You trust. Supreme Court is not Rahul Gandhi. You know, Supreme Court, you trust, you shared everything. Now, the point is that I really sympathize with my friend Mohammed Khan. I respect him a lot. He's one of the best spokesperson they have. But Mohammed Khan can't lie. I know this gentleman, but he's lying. So he's struggling. Because, you know, when you have to lie and then, you know, at that too at prime time, you find it very difficult. Okay. Now, if somebody says that I'm going to get 30,000 crore, if a person of Mohammed Khan's experience and a lawyer, and he says that is true. Point is that who has audited that?
Okay.
Please tell me the name of the auditor.
Okay.
Who has audited that they got 30,000 crores.
I think we got a clear idea.
If they're just basically daydreaming.
Yeah.
The point is, and a person like Mohammed Khan is buying it,
okay.
I sympathize with him.
I sympathize
because he's forced to lie.
All
he
right.
doesn't believe in it,
can
but he has to say it as part of his
can
work. Now, last line.
Yes. Yes.
The problem is, problem is that Congress is basically working very hard to build the whole thing which doesn't exist. They see ghosts everywhere into a kind of narrative that think the country will buy.
That's a political
process,
part to it.
They are
That's
going
a
to
political
lose
part
whatever
to it.
Credibility they have,
let me thank Vikas Singh and Chandru Sen for joining us on our first
like
big
Mohammed
debate on Viewpoint. But let me ask both the BJP spokesperson and the Congress spokesperson to hold on. I think the best way to look at what's happening on the Rafale deal is this, that for the first time, the government of the day has taken an aggressive step. An affidavit is not just some document which has been submitted in a court, it's a sworn affidavit. It can be a case of perjury if the government has put up something which is not believable, if the government has put up something which cannot be backed by fact. So in this round, war of words or otherwise with the opposition, the government certainly coming out all guns blazing on the aggression bit. Let's move on to the next big story. The big battle for states, Chhattisgarh, going to polls today. Each day, starting today, we'll get you all the latest action from the heat and dust of the electoral battlefield. You can look at any story across India. Today, that story is taking place. That politics is evolving only and only because there is something happening on the ground. And that is where the real story is. What's happened in Chhattisgarh today? Take a look at some of the statistics today. Polling has taken place across 18 constituencies. 70%. That's rather impressive if you have to compare it with the previous assembly election or even the previous Lok Sabha election. 70% voter turnout in the first phase. A total of 190 candidates in the fray, including Chief Minister Raman Singh himself, who's contesting now for a record fourth term. How many politicians can you think of? How many incumbent chief ministers can you think of who are contesting for a fourth term? Of the 18 seats which have gone to polls today, the BJP last time around had won 6. And typically, as happens in most elections in Chhattisgarh, the Maoist factor. That again has raised its ugly head. Maoist attack in Bijapur today. They tried to disrupt voting in many other areas. 5 CRPF jawans ended up being injured. The Prime Minister Modi, he was busy campaigning. While he was campaigning in Chhattisgarh, he launched a no-holds-barred attack against Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi. He said the Ma-Beta combination of the Gandhi Parivar is living on bail and they are living on bail because of policies which have been implemented by his government. He says it's demonetization and the resultant crackdown against shell companies, against Benami transactions that ended up leading it to a case being filed against Rahul Gandhi and Sonia Gandhi, and that's the main reason why they had to take bail from the court. The BJP president was also busy campaigning. He's attacked Rahul Gandhi, saying Rahul Gandhi suffers from Modi phobia, and therefore from Rafale deal to any other case, Rahul Gandhi is only and only thinking in terms of how to link that case to Narendra Modi. Chief Minister Raman Singh, he was also busy. He makes a claim that 14 seats will be won in the first phase itself, and they will certainly cross the 65-seat mark. But what was of great interest to me today, and each day we'll try and bring you the key stakeholders and what is it that they're saying. The battle for elections, and we've been seeing this in election after election, the discourse is only getting lower and lower and lower. Every politician that you can think of today, every politician is only busy trying to use words, trying to use adjectives to somehow try and settle this debate in their own favor. Take a look at how across the entire political trajectory, the length and breadth of all election-bound states from Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, how are the key stakeholders busy taking positions against each other? Just take a look at this.
भारतीय जनता पार्टी के कार्यकर्ताओं का लक्ष्य है कि विकसित मध्य प्रदेश को समृद्ध मध्य प्रदेश बनाकर देश के एक दो तीन नंबर के समृद्ध राज्यों में मध्य प्रदेश को पहुंचाना। साइड में रखते हुए कांग्रेस विकास के एजेंडे से अन्य मुद्दों पर ध्यान आकर्षित करना चाहती है।
जाओ, घर घर जाओ, द्वार द्वार खटखटाओ, जो नहीं समझा उसको भी समझाओ। मध्य प्रदेश की समृद्धि का जो मंत्र हमने दिया है, जो लक्ष्य हमने तय किया है, उसको पूरा करने के लिए जनता को आह्वान करो भारतीय जनता पार्टी को जिताने का।
एक एक बटन कमल में जब दबेगा तो आपका एक एक वोट डॉक्टर रमन को आशीर्वाद के रूप में मिलेगा। डॉक्टर रमन प्रत्याशी बन के चुनाव के मैदान में।
राजस्थान के युवाओं को तो है नौकरी की दरकार, पर मोदी जी और वसुंधरा जी चला रहे हैं पान पकौड़ा सरकार।
माँ बेटे रुपयों की हेरा फेरी में जमानत पे घूम रहे हैं, वो आज मोदी को प्रमाण पत्र दे रहे हैं। खुद रुपयों की हेरा फेरी में जमानत पर जो जी रहे हैं, जमानत पे बाहर घूम रहे हैं, वो औरों को ईमानदारी के सर्टिफिकेट बांट रहे, नोटबंदी का हिसाब मांगते। अरे नोटबंदी का कारण ही था कि फर्जी पकड़ी गई और फर्जी कंपनियां पकड़ी गई, उसी के कारण तो आपका कारोबार पकड़ा गया और उसी कारण आपको जमानत पे निकलना पड़ा। ये नोटबंदी के कारण आपको जमानत लेनी पड़ी।
अभी एक आदमी पत्रकार पूछ रहे थे हमको कि राहुल जी क्या ये सब अटर पटर बोलते रहते हैं। हमने कहा असल में समस्या इसलिए है कि सोनिया जी ने कभी छठ नहीं किया। अगर सोनिया गांधी जी छठ की होती तो बड़ा बुद्धिमान आता। मैंने छठ माँ की पूजा करने से बुद्धिमान बच्चे पैदा होते हैं।
ये जो शाह है ना, अमित शाह के नाम में, ये फारसी का नाम है। क्या करते देवालय कला,
straight away raised the big question in the context of the kind of statements which have been made by some leaders on the political battlefield. Is wartime discourse necessarily subject to this business of name calling? And does it really help people? Does it really help candidates? Let's welcome our guest, Amit Goel, Vice Chairman, Editorial Director of The Pioneer, is joining us live. So is Dhananjay Joshi, Director of Cicero. He's been busy doing a lot of number crunching for a whole range of organizations, and Narendra Taneja, spokesperson of the BJP. Dhananjay, let me just get you to respond to this one, sir. Look at what Manoj Tiwari says. He's your Delhi BJP president. You know, many leaders of the BJP never shy away from taking pot shots against the Congress members. But to use words like, you know, अच्छी माँ नहीं है, छठ की पूजा करती तो बुद्धिमान बेटा होता, आई कैन टेक इट इट्स अ जोक। इज इट अ जोक और इज इट अ Is it a blow below the belt, sir? How would you respond to that?
Well, Bhupen, I think it's a tough one in the sense that I think, in my personal view, it's important that, you know, we all, everyone, whether irrespective of which political party it is or, you know, I think certain, you know, in discourse, political discourse for that matter, you know, we need to maintain certain dignity. That's my personal view. And I see not only in politics, even in television studios, I participate in several debates these days. And especially in, sorry to say, but Hindi channels, I find. I mean, this has become a big issue. The kind of language even anchors have started using. So it seems it's not limited only to politics. It's in media, it's in TV debates, it's probably in debates outside and so on and so forth. Let's not forget one thing at the same time. And I'm not saying that who started it and all that. But you see, tall leaders of Congress party saying, you know, maut ka saudagar. Rahul ji saying khun ki dalali.
But what is it?
It's been going on for some time.
But Amit Goel, just because, Amit ji, just because the Congress...
But I'm not defending anyone.
Yeah, I know, I know. You know, it's interesting. It's interesting. I get your point, sir. You're saying that it's there everywhere.
No, I'm not saying that.
You're saying it's there everywhere. So politicians are also guilty of that. But Amit Goel, my point is, I mean, this is not the first time that we're seeing... It's not the first time, Amit Goel, that we're seeing high-stakes political battles. I want to know, when leaders, when tall leaders start resorting to this kind of language, does it really draw attraction of voters, supporters towards the leaders?
Well, it can draw attention, but it cannot draw votes. Because, you know, bad things never kind of seduces anybody. And but in modern politics, I fully respect and agree with Mr. Taneja that, you know, media, politicians, they all... This in modern day politics and media, this profanity is soon replacing the proficiency. We are not trying to be prude, you know, holier than thou, but the fact is something which you see and you dislike, something you hear and dislike should be avoided. And this is hitting below the belt, calling somebody's child buddhiman nahi hai and chhat puja karni chahiye thi. You know, this is completely avoidable. And see, in they're all parliamentarians. And in parliament, there is unparliamentary language. And as soon as any cuss word or a wrong word is used, it has to be withdrawn. And they all understand. But as soon as they're out of the parliament, they think that they're free to use the language they want. And you think they will get away with this and the public is going to accept it. I can never believe that any bad language or this below the belt sentences or adjectives and phrases can get you votes.
But Dhananjay, may I disagree? Dhananjay, may I disagree with both Amit Goel?
Dolly Bindra's, Rakhi Sawant, yeah, but and Hema Malini and Ashwara.
But may I disagree? May I disagree?
Well,
I would also
tend to disagree, Bhupen.
You know, because I think both Dhananjay ji and Amit Goel are taking holier than thou positions.
Right.
I think both of them are trying to be politically correct. Let's be clear. There's nothing like tadka in a political battle. Maybe politicians are aware of that. Maybe they realize you give tadka and maybe the possibility of getting votes on the basis of tadka increases, Dhananjay.
And how do you play it? You see, if you remember when Manishankar Iyer used the term
one moment.
Yeah, immediately
Dhananjay.
Given a caste angle. So you know, it's how you play it. Well, I was giving the example of Manishankar Iyer's calling the PM Neech. And it was immediately given a caste angle. And it was said that, you know, I'm being victimized because I'm a backward caste. And it was given as a message to the voters. Similarly, Maut Ka Saudagar is a good example. And I think it did play in, you know, the whole kind of communal polarization that was there in that 2007 Gujarat, 2012 Gujarat elections. So it's also about how you play these statements. How do you play this tadka? Because every tadka has a political connotation. After all, it's an election battlefield.
Now, Amit Goel, you may say that, you know, parliamentarians must behave in a certain way. And at the end of the day, they are parliamentarians. So they must use parliamentary language. But my point is this, Mr. Goel. The Prime Minister has converted referring to Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi as his ma beta ka jodi as some kind of a political masterstroke. And people seem to be buying that. So I say people are buying that. And if there is a certain connect which the Prime Minister manages to establish, why should he not do that? Why should he not tell the country that this Ma Beta is out on bail? He can say, oh, Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi are out on bail. Or he can say this Ma Beta Ki Jodi is out on bail. What's wrong with that?
It's a plain euphemism, and politicians tend to play like that. And it also sends a message that it's a dynasty rule in the Congress. This is what Prime Minister is trying to kind of see. There is a spontaneous reaction to a certain things, and sometimes we end up using bad words. When it is not spontaneous and it is planned, it is done with a purpose. I don't know whether public buys it or not. Just before this program started, you were giving example of Raman Singh, 15 years in power. I have not heard Raman Singh using this word. Sheila Dixit was in power for 15 years. I have not heard her using any bad words or bad language. Even I would say Shivraj Chauhan have not used such language. Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Indira Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Mahatma Gandhi, tall leaders, where have they used these bad words or any hurting language? So I think they should rise above these politics and they should stop thinking.
What times
this
have
can,
changed?
This,
but
Goel work saab, against
but Goel saab, there was no Twitter. Goel saab, opinion was not based on 140 characters on
times
Twitter.
Times have changed.
There was no Facebook. There was no Snapchat. Yeah. So maybe people have changed. Maybe society has changed. So why should politics and political discourse not change?
That's why I agree with Mr. Taneja. Media picks up these words. In olden days, when social media did not exist, newspapers would not kind of ever report such things. It would just let it pass because sometimes you end up using a new enthusiasm in a public rally, which is kind of, you know, very enthusiastic and clapping and applauding. So you kind of just end up playing to the gallery.
Taneja,
but the print media never reported these kind of things. Now with social media in place, everything is reported and captured.
But Taneja ji, what is this just
this
media?
This is modern politics.
Taneja ji, is this just media? I mean, let's be honest. I mean, all of you are trying to make it look like because the media looks for headlines. And therefore, politicians are falling for that trap. Why blame the media, sir? I mean, media is not responsible for creation of any wave or the lack of it. Taneja ji?
No. What has happened? I mean, look, what happened if you really dig into archives of recently concluded American congressional elections? The kind of language the politicians have been using there, never seen that before. We saw in Pakistan elections, for instance, the kind of language politicians. And India, again, as he said, and you know, in television studio, in social media, and various places, I mean, you see the kind of. But and with all sincerity, I want to point out one thing, you know, Bhupen. But if you look at, for instance, the first time a tall leader like Sonia Gandhi using the kind of language that she used in Gujarat against then Chief Minister of Gujarat, that was the, according to me, that was the beginning of the whole thing. The kind of language she used, not once, but several times.
But can I?
And after that, we saw at the height of, you know, surgical strike time, where Rahul Gandhi, Rahul Gandhi said, Khoon ki dalali. And now the point is that, and the way it was picked up by the media and social media. So today, media is not only formal media. Informal media, in terms of, you know, small people running their own thing, it has become now very difficult.
But Dhananjay, the truth is also this: did Rahul Gandhi, do the jadu ki jhappi? I mean, you know, for all that we're seeing now, you know, words being exchanged at the end of the day, Rahul Gandhi tried with love also. He went and did jadu ki jhappi with the Prime Minister.
Let me answer this.
I mean, what was that? Was that genuine in love?
Well,
Bhupendra, I think everybody is trying to pretend.
No.
Well, I really don't know what...
But you forgot about the wing.
Okay.
You forgot the wing. So, jadu ki jappi plus the wing. So, there is no seriousness. So, let's be clear. Dhananjay, is there no seriousness either, even with these words? This ma beta, this, you know, this, what is being said by Manoj Tiwari. And these are only statements which you picked up.
I don't know what else is happening in the heat and dust
of the electoral battlefield, Dhananjay.
Bhupen, I think, you know, these are individuals who are trying to put a certain kind of a position. When Rahul Gandhi comes and says that I am basically come from a political tradition where I am open to opposition, he goes and gives a jadu ki jhappi. He might be winking later. At the same time, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi said that Mr. Modi was a maut ka saudagar, Lohia way back in the 40s and 50s said that this is a kale angrezo ki azadi. So this kind of rhetoric has always been part of the political discourse.
Hmm.
The only change is that now an ordinary voter at the click of an Android button on his phone can straight away interact with the Prime Minister because of Twitter.
Okay.
That is the big change.
Okay. So you make a statement and that statement immediately generates a like on a Facebook or a tweet on Twitter. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on our second big debate on Viewpoint tonight. How will all this, all these actions that we see unfolding in front of us on a daily basis, how will all this ultimately impact the real battlefield? Each day, on the basis of the developments which have unfolded, we're going to give you a swing, a political swing. Who's higher on the political swing today? The government has decided to take the bull by its horns in the Rafale deal. Campaigning goes full on, but the fact that the government has decided to put up all facts on the Rafale deal in the Supreme Court just on the basis of that swing scale, I think Narendra Modi today certainly has managed to keep it slightly above the Congress party. The scales clearly on the basis of developments today tilted in favor of the Bharatiya Janata Party. Will it remain the same way tomorrow on the basis of developments that will unfold within the next 24 hours in the ever-changing world of Indian politics? We'll bring you up to speed with that as well. That's it from me on this edition of Viewpoint. Let's do a break. On the other side, Anand Narasimhan with the right stand.